Robert Bartha to utytułowany producent muzyczny i kompozytor pochodzenia węgierskiego, urodzony w Niemczech, w Kolonii. Wyprodukował i napisał piosenki dla Jose Carrerasa, mistrza boksu Wladimira Kliczko, znanej piosenkarki Leony Lewis, a także stworzył muzykę do różnych hollywoodzkich filmów. Jego produkcje trafiały na międzynarodowe listy przebojów, zdobywając platynowe i złote płyty. Artyści, z którymi współpracuje jako producent, są utożsamiani z różnymi gatunkami muzycznymi, poprzez klasyczny crossover, popowe i jazzowe produkcje, aż po muzykę spiritual. Robert Bartha jest również zaliczany do czołówki organistów. Jako endorser legendarnej wytwórni organowej wersji nagrał kilkanaście albumów solowych, koncertuje na całym świecie oraz w programach telewizyjnych. Na specjalnie dla niego zaprojektowanym instrumencie wykonuje epicką muzykę z mieszanką brzmień orkiestrowych połączonych z nowoczesnymi elementami, zastępując orkiestrę symfoniczną, big band, zespół rockowy czy DJ-a. Występował także jako headliner artystów na wielu międzynarodowych imprezach i festiwalach, otwierając występy międzynarodowych gwiazd, takich jak na przykład Michael Bublé. Kilka lat temu Robert przeniósł się na Majorkę, gdzie założył własną firmę producencką Emporio Productions oraz własną wytwórnię płytową RB Music Entertainment z siedzibą w Szwajcarii. Today I would like to introduce my dear friend, international musician, producer Robert Bartha. His roots are from Hungary. He was born in Germany and lived there many years. And as an artist and producer, he was working there with many international projects and artists all over the world. And now he's living in Spain. Since 4 years. So welcome, dear Robert, in my program, Musical Journeys Online. Hello.
Hello, Alicja. Nice to see you.
Thank you. How are you today? How is situation now in Spain? Can you tell us with this all pandemic times? And please tell us a little bit about nowadays.
Yeah. Well, I feel very good today. The sun is shining, you cannot see at the moment, but outside it's blue heaven, it's always sun. I live on Mallorca, the island of Spain, so it's a little bit different to Spain, because Mallorca is a little bit easier, you know, it's not that much cases here, so we are quite relaxed about that.
Okay. At the moment. Okay. I envy you your sunny weather.
Yes.
In Poland nowadays is not so sunny anymore. I think yes. In Germany too. But
no,
you are lucky.
Time to Spain.
Sorry?
Time to move to Spain, I
said. I will think about it. Okay, so let us start maybe from the beginning. Can you tell us a little bit about your childhood? I mean, about your musical roots. How was it? How it had happened that you became musician, artist? How was your childhood and teenager? Elaborate about that, please.
Of course, yes. I started quite late with music. I always loved to listen to music, but I never played an instrument. And until I was about 14 years old, and in the school, I had a friend, he had an organ at home. And so when I was at his home and listened to this instrument, I was fascinated by this instrument. It was able to do so many different sounds and to you could perform all kind of music. And so I was really on my parents like, oh, please, I want to have an organ. Ah. And so Christmas came and they gave me an organ. And so I had lessons and everything. So later on, I started also playing the piano and everything with keys, keyboards and everything. And so I became fascinated about doing myself music. And after about 1.5 years, my teacher was like, I cannot teach you anymore because you know everything. So it went really, really quick. And after 2 years, starting with the organ, I played my first concert. And even 1 year later, I was on tour in all over Europe and even USA and everywhere. And well, my roots are coming maybe from my grandparents or exactly from my grandfather, Menesi Laszlo. He was an orchestra musician on Budapest in the opera, in the opera house. And also he wrote a lot of partitures of sheet music, and he gave me all that sheet music and I played it on the organ. So he was really, he was a genius because he could write for orchestra all the sheets, and he didn't need an instrument for that. He just wrote all the partitures and everything, and it was amazing.
Oh, so I've heard that the strongest talents we got from grandparents, you know, so probably you got it from your grandfather, who was conductor, yes, you said, in Budapest Opera House.
Yes.
Okay.
His instrument was actually a horn, the French horn. And he played it in the opera house in Budapest, but also he conducted and he wrote all the sheets for the whole orchestra. And so he was a multi-purposes.
So your parents are not musicians, right?
They love music, and my mother, she liked to play a little bit keyboards and stuff. But you know, these were maybe different times, like they was not in the position to afford an instrument when they were young. They were happy to afford some food or some having some work and whatever, you know. And so they always dreamed about to play an instrument, but they never get to that point. So
okay, and your childhood you spent in Cologne, I guess, yeah, in Germany.
Yeah, close to Cologne, a little bit on the countryside, but like 20 minutes from Cologne. Yeah.
Okay.
And yeah, there was all these lessons with the instrument and the musical education. Later on, I also visited conservatorium.
Conservatory.
Yeah.
You studied in Academy of Music, conservatory.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
With organ or?
Yes, I had this classical organ and jazz about harmonies. Learned a lot, and so yes, that was also one part of that. But at that time, I already started to produce music. So I played the instruments. I made concerts all over the world, and then I thought about, okay, is that all? No, there is some more I want to do. And so I started to compose music. I started to produce music, to record my own stuff, and to start to work with other artists. And that was an amazing, amazing experience.
Oh yeah. So please, can we get to know a little bit details about that, because I think it's really interesting. Like you said, you started to produce music, but can you tell us how was the beginning? You start to work with who first? And I know that it's a lot, and we will not have so many time that you will tell us about all artists you were working, but can you name a little bit, maybe some artists and you produced for? And I know that you got a lot of awards as well for that. So please, can you tell us a little bit about your maybe most memorable productions?
Sure, yes. Well, there are a few, as you said, and it would take maybe some hours to talk about everything. But, well, of course, when I started to produce music, I had just a small computer. I had a little drum computer. I had a little keyboard. So it was very, very small equipment. And But there was many ideas in my head. So I started to try this and try that. And well, the first production was the song I Just Wanna Dance. And well, I didn't have a studio at that time. So I had to ask a friend and had to rent a studio for some little money. And I also had to rent some artists. There were a rapper and a black singer, and it was a big first experience. And that song already went to the advertising music. Maybe you remember C&A, the fashion label,
yes,
C&A.
Of course.
And they chose that song like an official advertising song, and they made a music video of that and it ran on MTV, and I couldn't believe what happened. So I thought, wow, this is my music, they play my song, it's unbelievable. And yes, but it was true. And so I got addicted to it. I thought, well, that's great, I want to do more and more and more. And so yes, later I had a very first, you can say, a world successful hit in the charts. It was released in 40 countries. That was In the Ghetto, the cover version of the Elvis classic. This was produced still not in my studio, it's still in a rent studio, but it was, yes, it was in
huge success. I remember that in Poland we
yes,
the song when I was 10. Teenager.
Yes, it was top 10 in Poland, I remember, and it was top 10 in many charts all over Europe, even in the USA and everywhere. So this was my first golden record, golden award, platinum record. So it was like, wow, what is happening? You know, I couldn't believe. And but you know, it was always like I never produced things about looking on the market and what are the people buying and I want to earn money with that. It was never that behind. It was more, oh, I have an idea and I want to do that and that. And so it was always more the passion, and even if they wouldn't pay me, I would have done it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that changed. But
good that they pay you. Anyway.
But anyway, and so this was really the start, the international come out with success and awards, and remarkable productions followed later, like José Carreras, the classical tenor. He used a song which I composed, or the boxing champion Vladimir Klitschko. He was walking the box ring for his fight with my anthem. There was some American movies which used my music. I composed for 5 American movies. I made a remix album from Leona Lewis as well. I produced it. And so there are a few names which are really nice to have in my vita, you know. It's
mm-hmm.
it's an honor to work and collaborated with those. But also, what was even more important always for me, to find artists, to discover artists, to develop artists, you know, to when, let's say, there is a newcomer, a talented newcomer, but he has actually no chance on the big music market. So I like to form and to create and to bring him out and to make things possible.
And this is how we met, Elizabeth.
Yeah. Exactly.
Because we met, not everybody knows, I think Robert came to concert when I was playing with Ray Wilson, and we chat, and then we start to cooperation. So he said maybe we can record something together, and now we are here.
That was also an amazing thing because, well, I saw you playing with Ray Wilson on stage and I thought, wow, what a great violinist you are, and I want to work with you. Yes, that's true. So I wanted to always to work with you, and we started quite soon with the first single, Children, which we released. Some projects like with the Children Are the Future or some Christmas songs, and La Serenissima from Rondo Veneziano we recorded, and we made a music video here on Mallorca, you remember, and it was even awarded and nominated on two international film festivals. So we already have this little success, and now I think we are ready to record your solo album and to bring it out.
Yeah, because of course, unfortunately, there are pandemic times and we don't have concerts. Musicians are actually suffering, but that's a positive thing that now some of musicians which are touring all the time, now there is the time that we can cooperate, we can record at last album. Like in our case, I think you also traveling and making concerts with Orgel, with Versi. I will ask you about it later, but I wanted to come back a little bit to this. When you said about producing music, it is like that when you made some thing and then somebody heard that they just call you, yeah, in our world. I wanted to tell how it looks like, because you were independent producer, or you were that time with some label or with some how no. It is in industry. Can you tell a little bit like it was earlier, like it is now, maybe now it's changing a little bit, because it's really interesting how it looks, all music industry.
it is quite interesting, because the change in the last, let's say, 20 years, what happened is so huge, you know. When I started to produce music, the regular way was like, I produce a song, I go to the record companies, I offer the music, they say, yes, we like it, we sign it, and so they release it, they put all the money to promote it and everything. So that was the old school, the old fashioned way of music releasing and producing. And today, let's be honest, the big studios are getting less and less and less, you know. Many talented creative people, even maybe you cannot call them really producer, they just creative people. They get them a machine and a MacBook and they start to produce music, you know, so-called produce, because maybe they even don't know about music or even don't know about what is a note or what is a harmony, or they just don't have a clue, but they have this machine and they start to be creative, and it's not bad, you know. It's they earn hits, they have success, so and that changed totally, and they don't go to labels anymore. Sometimes they just release it itself, you know, like themselves. They release it on Spotify or wherever. Yeah. And so sometimes artists ask me, what I need a label for today? Mm-hmm. I can release myself. Well, you can, of course, but if you have a label, you can operate international. You have more impact on the market. You know, you talk with your connections, with your network, and they are radio people, they are TV people, and they, of course, they are open-eared when you are a label and you have an artist, and the artist don't have to fight himself and go to the radio. It's your producer, your manager, your label, they push you, and this is still old school. They like that, you know. The radios like when the manager is coming and say, I have a great artist for you, and this stuff, you know. So a label is still explainable why it's good still to collaborate with a label and or with a producer or whatever, you know. So it's not so bad to have a manager, but you have to trust, you have to work good together. It doesn't make sense if they just think about money, then it makes no sense at all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's changed, like you said, a little bit. I think it's good to connect to these two words as well somehow, because there's a lot of great musicians who are trying to make music, like, you know, to be seen, and they are putting clips on YouTube, but of course you need to have really big luck to get millions of views, right? So still, if you've got labor and somebody who is making this connection, it can be done and can cooperate in this world as well. Yeah,
it helps a lot. If you have a label, it helps a lot, because they can do many things for you. You know, they can push you forward. They can also get the best out of you, create with you together, to just to show some options, what is possible. You know, they create an image, what is really important to have a how can I explain, to be credible, the credibility.
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
The credibility of an artist is so important. He has to be authentic, of course. Mm-hmm. If I would be like an artist working with a label, I never would do music which is not authentic for me. It should be authentic, because the people, they feel if you are authentic. And this is for me the most important parameter which has to be there when you work with somebody. And then in this 20 years ago, we sold a lot of CDs. Today, we don't sell CDs anymore. We sell downloads and streamings, you know. So that's also the biggest change in the music industry. And I had both sides. I had this big CD era, and I also see now what in the digital marketing.
So our thinking needs to a little bit change and accommodate to the new world, right?
And yes.
Yeah, so yeah, and it's good, like you said, it's good that technique evolved and grew up, and of course some of people can get luck and can be seen, and maybe their YouTube clips went viral, and that's as well how they make career in nowadays.
Yes.
Earlier it wasn't like that, because they couldn't have this chance, and it's good.
Yes.
That technique is growing, but still I think, like you said, it's good to be authentic and but have this background basis and cooperate with people who knows how to do it.
Yes. Effect, please. It's, you know, when you're an artist and you have your own style, and that's why you are authentic, because you have your own style, you have your own vision, and you have your language of music. This is so important to earn visibility and have credibility. And otherwise, we have millions. And if they try this and that, but they really don't know who I am, you know, you have to know who I am, what I'm standing for, which music is identified with my person, or which music I identify with. And this is so important to think about that.
Okay. So now we can maybe talk a little bit about you as an artist, musician as well, not only producer. So you are still playing orgel like in your childhood, but now you are, I think, endorser of Versi company.
Yes.
And you are touring with them. So I think now all tours are cancelled, unfortunately, but can you tell us about your concert with Versi and artist? Maybe you perform as well with, please.
Well, this, you can imagine, this is a huge organ which can make all sounds you can imagine. So you can play like a symphony orchestra or just a church organ, but also synthesizer and all kind of sounds. And so I play concerts with a lot of film, movie music, musicals, jazz, but also my own compositions. So it's a mix of all. You have to imagine this organ, this big organ has sound like a symphonic orchestra, but also like a synthesizer. You can play modern songs, you can play swing, jazz, all kind of music. And so I was honored to play some introduce concerts for great people like Michael Bublé, for example. And so, of course, this was not my audience, it was the audience of Michael Bublé, but they get know me in this way, you know. There were like 15,000 people in this arena. Mm-hmm. And they saw this instrument and said, "What is this? I never saw something like that." And is he playing live? This is impossible. Yes, it is possible. You know, you sound like a big band, and it's possible to play it with two hands and two feet. And so they were really, really freak out, the people. They say, "Wow, this is great." And of course, I played some songs of Michael Bublé as well. Yeah, and it's a lot of fun to play this music, you know. That's what I enjoy so much in the music. When I produce in the studio with other artists, get the best out of what is possible, and also go on stage and give the audience a lot of nice moments of joy, of, you know, emotions. And this is fulfilling, very, very nice to do.
Yes, I have to tell, I've heard as well you on concert, and once we even played together with, you were playing on Versi with also with other musicians, Liane Evers, and it was on Neuroscience Gala, and actually, you record that so people can buy it. Also have recorded your live concert on Versi, yeah. So if somebody is interested, can buy it. We talk about a little bit about music industry, about concerts. Maybe can you tell us about your present projects, what you're up to? I know a little bit about that, but can you tell us about your present project?
Well, there are a few very, very nice projects at the moment, present projects. One of these is a great singer from Malta named Ozzy Lino. I just produce his album. You know it's you, there's no way around. What you need is some love. There is another project, which is a spiritual duo called Suniai, and they sing mantras, but we released the album in this year, like around March, we had the first single, and in June came the album, and it was worldwide, it topped the charts in the New Age charts, it was number one in 12 countries, the album, so was a big success. I'm very happy about it because it's kind of healing music, you know, it's like it has 528 hertz and it's another frequency and you feel it. It's very healing and it communicates with the DNA, with the nature and everything. So this is an interesting project. And I also produce the solo album of this great, beautiful violinist, Alicja Chrząszcz.
Okay.
Which is on the desk now. And what I really like, you can work with artists from all over the world. I received yesterday vocals from Bangladesh, you know, because I cannot travel there. She cannot travel here. She's a singer from Bangladesh, Konal. And she sent me yesterday the vocals for the song, where you are featured as well. It is a project with artists are featured from 10 nations. And this is so beautiful, you know, we have such an international artist range. And this will be released in March 2021.
Okay, so really looking forward as well, because I was, like you said, a little far in that.
Yes.
And
Roman Naya. Well, he's a German artist, so-called Schlager. You know Schlager in Poland? I don't know.
Yeah.
So maybe you have Polish Schlager?
Yes. No, we have.
I guess it is. And yes, he is very successful. He's a rising Schlager star, you can say. And he's doing very well with his first album as well. It's just released.
I personally, I am really interested in your album, this with this higher frequency.
And yes.
I've heard that once. And like you said, it's really for people who are connecting with nature and more spiritual, even not actually for everybody, it's good, but you can feel it. You can feel this peaceful energy, I would say, like that.
Yes, that's true.
Yeah,
that's true. And it was very special. We released it in beginning of March, the first single called Suniai. And what happened is most of the people worldwide had a lockdown.
Yeah.
And this music, for many people, this music was like healing music. And we saw it on the downloads and streams. We had in short time, we had over 100,000 streams with that song. And that was a document of like, the people are at home, they are looking for health, for, you know, and it was quite the right time to release it. It was not planned because nobody could plan the pandemic, but well, maybe yes, not us.
Yeah, it's a really mysterious thing, I guess. Anyway, maybe, do you have any German melody, do you remember from your childhood, or German songs? Because we'd like to talk a little bit about Germany here as well. Do you have, do you remember any specific melody, maybe from your childhood, or maybe some hits, artists, German artists?
Well, my parents, They had a record player with vinyl records, and they had some German music records, like from Udo Jürgens, maybe you know.
Uh-huh, I've heard the name.
He's very famous even in out of Germany, or Peter Alexander, and yes, I remember a lot of songs of them, like, let's say, Griechischer Wein, or Mit 66 Jahren, and German old Schlager, but it's not that Schlager what is today Schlager. It was more like singer-songwriter, what is singer-songwriter today.
I remember from my teenager times, it was Die Fantastischen Vier. I really liked it.
Dida. Yes, they had a song, Dida.
Oh yeah, and artists like DJ Bobo. Yeah. It's 90s, right? Yeah. When the you 90s were producing.
Yes. I mean, the 90s were great, like Sing Hallelujah, Mr. Vain, yes, and all the dance floor stuff. It came up. That was great.
Yeah. Yes, and it was actually, I have to tell you that it was really popular in Poland also.
Yes. But you like also the 80s, because the 80s were great as well. It was all that ABBA and Depeche Mode, and you know, this electronic, but yes, still with...
Yes, of course. Yeah. And how about the food? Do you like some German food? A little bit.
With me, you can always talk about food. I love food.
But specifically German?
Well, it depends, because, you know, my roots are Hungarian, and of course my parents are cooking Hungarian dishes, and I love them, you know. It's like Csirke paprikás, and yes, so many nice dishes. But of course, in Germany you have, for example, sauerkraut with some meat, and yeah, that's nice as well. And I love Spanish food now, very, very addicted to. It's beautiful to eat a paella or whatever. And what I always was addicted to is Italian food. But you see, I love food.
Okay, and do you like beer?
Well, not that much. I have to be honest. Beer is not my favorite drink, but to be honest, the Spanish beer is really nice to drink, yeah.
Okay.
I have to try the Polish food still.
Oh yeah, you need to try. Actually, you never been in Poland. I'm always to invite you.
Yeah, I didn't follow your invitation yet. It will be after the pandemic, I will. But I've been in Warsaw, in Poland. That was very, very nice to be there. Beautiful city, I enjoyed a lot, and I had some nice food there as well, but I cannot remember the name of it.
Maybe pierogi.
maybe.
Yeah. Okay, so what's important in your life right now in music career? What do you think?
Well, that's always, you know, it's always creating, having ideas, realize projects. That's so exciting, so amazing to do.
Yeah. Okay, Robert, so thank you very much that you agreed to talk to me today. And I wish you all the best for your future project, for our project, and have a good, nice evening in Mallorca. And I hope we will see after pandemic times soon.
Thank you, Alicja, for the talk. And yes, I cannot wait until we all of us artists can go back to the stage, go back on tour, and enjoy what we really love, right?
Yes. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Bye.